We're living in a new age of invention. Brilliant brains no longer just hold up in leading university labs or research facilities.
Today, inventors are coming together in technology hubs like this to design.
To help improve people's lives.
It's actually working. That's so cool.
For this series, we brought together seven of the UK's leading engineers, designers, and computer programmers.
Ta-da!
I'm gonna make myself the guinea pig.
They will use cutting-edge science and technology to build life-changing solutions for people in desperate need.
I don't know who to ask or where to go.
In pain, uncomfortable.
From helping individuals who are seriously ill.
Whoa!
To solving issues affecting entire communities.
Someone's either going to get seriously injured and can't get aid, or someone's going
to
die.
They'll attempt to tackle major problems that have so far gone unsolved.
I think I've created something really new and possibly revolutionary.
The potential of this is massive.
Fingers crossed nothing cracks or explodes.
This week, they'll try to give a voice to a paralysed man who can no longer speak.
To enable him to have a bit of quality of life, I'll do anything.
They'll attempt to give a teenage boy the chance to ride a bike for the very first time.
This exercise has really illustrated how difficult it is.
If you don't succeed, try again.
And they'll design new technology they hope will stop a national crime wave.
9 of them dead, they got suffocated. Police don't have a chance, you know, they've got to catch them red-handed.
If they succeed, they could change these people's lives. And the lives of many more.
It's life changing.
Our team's base is in East London. It's one of a national network of makerspaces for a new generation of inventors. Crammed full of the latest technology. It's from here that our seven leading inventors will attempt to create fixes for people with nowhere else to turn.
I'm really excited about what we're going to learn. I can't wait to meet these people.
The team includes a director from Microsoft, engineers who worked at Dyson's innovation labs, award-winning designers who've built everything from ambulances to earthquake sensors.
Let's get our sleeves rolled up and get stuck in.
I'm Simon Reeve. Over the next 9 months, I'll be working with this brilliant team. Today I'm in Peterborough, meeting the first person who's asked for the team's help.
It's first floor for Graham. This is Graham.
Hello, Graham.
Fist bump, I gather.
55-year-old Graham Bullivant has partial locked-in syndrome and desperately needs a better way to communicate.
There is no rush. Go as whatever speed you want. Don't rush for us.
In 2014, Graham, an engineer and family man, suffered a massive stroke. He now only has limited movement of his head and left arm.
In pain all the time. I am sure people forget.
His wife, Zoe, has been at his hospital bedside every day for nearly 2 years. Graham's brain works perfectly.
I am normal inside. If Zoe's with me, I can face anything. I get frustrated. I bet you do. The technology must be a bit frustrating as well. This strikes me as being a hell of a lot better than nothing, but a really inadequate form of communication.
It takes Graham more than 3 minutes to write a sentence that would take just seconds to say. I watch and wait and then read out what he's tapped.
It's too slow. I can see everyone watching and reading out of the corner of my eyes. And I'm wanting to say the words and break the silence while you're tapping away. Must be incredibly frustrating for somebody who's very used to conversing, talking, chatting.
The stylus I invented. Because we've brought so many stylists for Graham to try. They're either too heavy or too short.
After an hour of writing, Graham is exhausted, so we leave him to rest.
Happy with that? Can you face talking about what life was like before it happened?
Before?
Mm.
Oh, brilliant. Oh, my God. Fantastic. Every day was a blessing.
You were married... You've been married for how long?
Over 30 years. Way over 30 years. I was spoilt, really. He did everything for me. Had nice times, had holidays. He took all that pressure. And now it's my turn and, my God, it's come as a big shock.
When was the last time you actually heard his voice?
14 months ago. When Graham lost his voice, and I said to everybody, one of the things I said to all my friends and family, get a recording of your husband or boyfriend, because my God, did I miss that, that good night, I love you. That was horrendous, not having his voice. So I asked everybody, he got video. Nothing. But I'll do anything for Graham. No, I've got to. To enable him to have a bit of quality of life.
Back at the Inventors Hub in London, we talk through Graham's case.
What do we think at the moment Graham wants?
He wants to be able to communicate like he used to. He's got to tap it all out. And it's so frustrating. I mean,
yeah, absolutely.
When you're hanging out with your family, you want to express yourself emotionally and quickly.
It's what makes us us.
With these devices, they don't have an emphasis on, I would like to be sarcastic.
So that's something that we could, you know, help with, try and figure out a way to get digital voice to sound sarcastic.
It's something very profound that we're discussing, really, isn't it? It's not just giving him a new voice. In a way, it's giving him his old voice back.
Yusuf Mohammed is an award-winning industrial designer who's worked extensively with the NHS. Today, he's taking me to look for alternatives for Graham's stylus pen and iPad. We meet Gary Derwent, an expert in assisted technologies.
So we're just seeing that the system is picking up your eyes.
He's going to demonstrate a system called eye gaze.
Stable signal.
W. E.
Get ready to watch the orange circle.
This is the jewel in the crown of communication aids, where an infrared camera allows you to control the system with your eyes alone.
It's taking about 25 pictures a second of your eyes to differentiate the centre of your pupil and what they call the glint in your eye. When your eyes move, the glint stays in the same place, but the centre of your pupil moves.
It's looking for the glint in my eye.
It is.
Brilliant. It is. I love it.
You select letters or words by letting your gaze rest on them for a moment.
Hi. There. Now.
And it uses an artificial voice, letting the user join in the conversation.
Hi there, how are you doing?
It feels like I'm controlling the device with my mind. What extraordinary technology.
Hi, Simon, I'm doing well. I am right here with my eyes.
The eye gaze could be the basis for a new communication system for Graham.
Amazing.
But Yusuf doesn't think it will solve all of his problems.
Fatigue is such a big, big thing. And I can tell from just trying the system that maintaining your gaze, I'm sure after a while it's going to be quite laborious. So maybe he could use the pen from time to time, or he could use a switch controller.
The next step is for Gary to meet Graham and assess him.
So we're just going to do some calibration. These are the eye gaze cameras here at the bottom. So there's going to be a dot that will appear in the screen and it'll move around. So your job is just to look at the dot and follow it. Are you finding that the dot is following your eye? No, it's not picking up exactly where you're looking at. No.
Nerve damage caused by the stroke has affected Graham's eyes and pupils, so the camera is struggling to follow his gaze.
Looking at what we've just witnessed might be the wrong route.
So if eye gaze isn't the thing, that's fine, you know, it isn't right for everybody.
I'm really pleased that you've come so you can see how we're struggling. But obviously, if that's not the right angle to go down, we'll try something else. I'm not giving up.
Yes.
It's hugely disappointing. The eye gaze system doesn't work for Graham. Another solution has to be found. Back at the Inventors Hub, The team are getting ready for their next challenge, to build a bike for Oscar, a disabled teenager. Yusuf will lead the case.
Why did you want to get involved with this particular fix?
Well, I mean, I love bikes and I'm really passionate about cycling, and I think it's the kind of extra freedom it gives you. We used to cycle to and from the park, the wind in my hair when I had hair. And it's the independence, being able to explore your local areas is very cool.
You sound like the right man for this fix, Yusuf.
I hope so.
We're in the West Midlands to meet Oscar, who seems to be a whiz in the kitchen. He puts us to work.
Chop some mushrooms, maybe?
I think you'll find that's my job. We've been here at least 2 minutes and we haven't had a cup of tea. What are you like? Are you a keen cooker, Oscar?
Yeah.
What do you like about it? The eating or the...
cooking.
Oscar has Möbius syndrome, a rare genetic condition which means he was born with no hands or feet.
I can do the same as everyone, but it would like take me a little bit longer.
Right.
But there's something his friends can do that Oscar can't, and that's ride a bike.
You've got two different prosthetics on the lower legs, haven't you?
Yeah.
And obviously that's going to have an impact on how Yusuf creates the cycle for you.
Mm. You're coming, you're going to perch in.
I learn more about Oscar's condition from his mum, Lisa.
So he's got heels on both.
Yeah.
And ankle joints. But you say he's got sort of a third to a half of a foot on this side.
What did he say?
Can I have a drink?
He's off. He's such a lad. He's really just about to become a teenager.
Oh, yes.
And for teenage boys, bikes aren't just about getting around. They're part of growing up. Without a bike, Oscar's being left behind.
To just kids their age, however thoughtful they are, at some point they're going to want to cycle away.
Yeah.
And then he's left standing there on his own.
It's impossible for Oscar to ride a standard bike because he has no hands to grip the handlebars. Yusuf needs to come up with a custom alternative. We've come to Oscar's school to get a better idea of what he wants.
Oscar, which handlebars do you prefer?
These.
Seat.
This one, I want that one.
Oh.
Yeah, that one goes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What bikes are cool at the moment?
BMX.
So BMXs are cool and that's what you would like?
Yeah.
You think he'd much prefer a sort of a standard bike. Why was that?
Because all his life he just didn't want to be known as different, really. He just wants to fit in.
What is the most important thing to you about a bike?
Make it look like as normal as possible.
Yep. I understand.
Back at the hub in London, the team are discussing the challenge.
Well, Oscar's never ridden a bike before. Really just depends on how he takes to it.
Isn't this a really tricky one?
It's really, really tricky.
If we're trying to engineer something which is two wheels, that's obviously a real challenge. If he falls off, he could get quite hurt.
We need to think about, like, would I be okay with this guy falling off a bike that I built?
There's a lot of downside to making this thing.
I don't know, I guess if you're going to graze your knees and fall off bikes, you know, this is the best age to do it.
If you give him the opportunity to cycle, he will fall off, certainly, but he will fly as well, and that will change his life, I think.
Knowing the risks, Yusuf has come up with a plan.
So I have ordered myself an adult BMX. I'm going to make myself the guinea pig, try out a couple of these things so I can have an understanding of what's going to work for Oscar. I mean, how's he going to steer? I have to consider how he's going to brake. So what we have here is a coaster brake right there in the center of the wheel. All Oscar has to do is backpedal and the bike will brake hands-free.
It's down to the park to try out his first prototype.
Pretty easy. You can kind of screech to a halt.
It works fine, but it doesn't have enough stopping power. Oscar will need a brake on the front wheel as well.
I've designed a new brake position. Rather than pull the levers, I've reversed the brake position so that Oscar, all he has to do is push down with his forearms and he can activate the brakes.
Back in the park, the front brake is proving to be a problem.
You see, I can do it now. Now I can use that brake and feel fine. But as soon as I'm standing up, I've got no bloody chance.
BMXs aren't really designed to be ridden sitting down. As soon as he operates the brake standing up, Yusuf loses his balance.
I think this exercise has really illustrated how difficult it is. On a BMX like this, it's not going to happen.
It's not going to work.
No.
Adapting an off-the-shelf bike won't work. Yusuf will have to build a completely new bike from the bottom up. The team are trying to design a way for Graham to communicate. Ruby Steele is now leading the effort to find a solution.
What's the absolute minimum effort required to make a control happen?
She's a top design strategist. Through in-depth research into Graham and his condition, she'll decide what path the team will take.
It's like driving a car, like, you know, you use like your hands and you use your feet, so you're not putting all the emphasis on just one movement.
After weeks of discussions and thousands of post-it notes, the team decide to build Graham his own bespoke communication system. They're calling it the Reaction Pad.
The Reaction Pad is about giving Graham back his presence in a room. The really tragic and most frustrating thing for Graham at the moment is that people are treating him like he's brain dead when he's not. The key thing is that he can say just a quick statement whenever the urge comes across. So it's just really key phrases that will allow him to be part of a conversation in a way that he just can't at the moment.
Ruby's in Peterborough to discuss the idea with Graham.
Hi, it's good to see you. Hi, Graham. Hi, Zoe. This is Ross.
Hi, Ross.
Hello.
Another member of the design team.
Ross Atkin is a skilled designer and engineer who specialises in developing technology for disabled people.
What we're proposing is an app that runs on the iPad.
We're sort of calling it the Reaction Pad at the moment, and it's in essence going to be a tablet to say things quickly.
Their idea is for Graham to communicate using preloaded words and phrases.
When you pick up the tablet, open up the app, whatever, this is the first screen that you see.
Help, in the middle, as being the most important thing.
When Graham pushes help, he'll be taken to another screen that contains different commands.
In pain, uncomfortable, thirsty.
The app will contain buttons for quick statements.
Things like please, thank you.
Buttons for fast questions.
What, why, how.
And buttons to get people's attention.
Excuse me, oi, talk to me.
The device will speak for Graham using an automated voice.
One of the things we were trying to explore is what we could do that would be a sort of replacement of the robot voice. They don't tend to be very expressive, and they don't tend to have a lot of emotion. We were interested in the idea of using clips from films and TV and cartoons.
Good. Or scrap.
Good.
Good.
He's smiling like a Cheshire cat.
And Ross thinks he can improve on Zoe's homemade stylus.
We know that you get tired operating the stylus, and so we're quite interested in things that might work better than the stylus. We could make you a thing that was just on a bit of cardboard or a very, very thin and light, and it could have little touch pads basically printed on it so that you could touch them with your fingers or with the stylus.
Okay. Thank you, Graham. See you next week.
Yeah, take care.
Have a drink for me.
All right.
Can definitely take care of that.
Yeah, can definitely do that.
Thanks, Graham.
Thank you, Graham.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, nice meeting you.
Yusuf is heading back to the West Midlands. The first BMX he adapted wouldn't work for Oscar, so he's decided to come up with an entirely new design.
I'm just going to offload so we can do some different exercises today.
First thing we can see is the seat is a bit low already.
He's building a customized bike for Oscar, and he needs precise measurements.
Pedal fast. Okay, steer left. And brake you go.
That's fine.
I think we've got the makings of a bike design.
Once Yusuf has the measurements, he transfers them onto the rear of a tandem bike for Oscar to test. But there's a problem.
I'm not going on this. No.
Oscar's never been on a moving bicycle before. He's worried.
Do you know my worries?
Yep.
My worries, you're going to make me fall off.
Yep.
I don't really think I can ride a bike. And I'm scared. They're my worries.
I think it's natural to feel scared.
I'm not riding.
It's a scary thing.
I'll only do it.
Yep.
If someone is holding the back of me. Because if I fall, I don't want to die.
You're not going to die.
It's on your bike.
Go on, have a go.
I fall off, I'm suing.
Okay.
No jokes.
Okay, so we're going to start slowly. I'm not going to pedal, we're just going to go forward. Okay? So you pedal. You pedal.
Trust him.
Please help me.
Okay, now I think it'd be worth giving a go without mum.
No, that's not.
Go on then.
Fine.
I'll hold on if that's going to be a problem.
Go.
Here we go.
Yeah.
Come on!
I'm here. I'm holding on.
Holding the balance. Yeah?
Yeah.
I think you can let go, Mum.
I'm letting go. Look up.
Easy. You ready to stop?
Yeah. Come on. Again.
Yeah, ready to go again?
Mum, you gotta hold me.
Ready? Easy. We've got this. Great work. Go all the way.
Keep going to the end.
It's wonderful to see, and he's absolutely thrilled about it because he wants to keep doing it. It's lovely.
It's about him being the same. It's just kids their age, however thoughtful they are, at some point they're going to want to cycle away, and then he's left standing there on his own.
Keep going!
And I didn't want him to have to go through that. If he's got a bike, he's able to be the same as everybody else.
Thank you, Yusuf.
Yeah, no problem.
My hair messed up.
No, it's perfect.
It's good, yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
Yusuf begins designing a bespoke BMX bike for Oscar.
I'd like to move the seat slightly more forward and a little bit more upright. What this is going to do is allow Oscar to put most of his weight on his bum.
Changing the angle of the seat post has a knock-on effect for every angle on the bike frame.
I'm going to set this to 260.
Steel tubes are cut precisely to match Yusuf's drawings. Then TIG welded together to make the frame. It's a long process with some late nights for Yusuf. While Yusuf is building, Oscar's in training.
Go, Oscar. Pedal.
He's learning from professional cycling coach Lisa Costa.
I think what we'll do, we've got a bit more length that way, haven't we? So if we go down there...
Oscar's made good progress on the mountain bike. But because he can't pull on the handlebars, starting and stopping is proving tricky.
Pedal.
Designing the fixes is a long, arduous process.
Well done. Give me high five.
It's 3 months since the first prototype, and only now has Yusuf been able to complete version 2 of the BMX.
So...
wow, look at that.
This here
is the prototype, a BMX style frame, BMX wheels. What do you think, Oscar?
Yeah,
think?
I like it.
What about you, Lisa?
Practical wise, I'm a little bit concerned because there's no gearing.
Yeah.
It's quite hilly around here, and he's going to find it difficult going up the hills with this.
Lisa's also concerned about the BMX's dimensions.
Just want to get on the bike for us. His old posture's...
It's more it's just too, leaning too, forward.
Yeah. And see how high his knees are coming up?
Yep.
We need shorter cranks.
Yeah, we do.
But shortening cranks, the stems for the pedals, will make pedalling harder.
I do really want a BMX.
I am super keen that this BMX frame, we find a configuration that will work with him.
If you don't succeed, try again.
I always find as a designer, you just get, people tell you it's completely wrong over and over again until it's right. So you have to kind of have a thick skin, and you have to appreciate that ultimately, in order for it to work, it's going to be wrong for a long time. It's going to be wrong for a while, if that makes sense. So, yeah, we just have to roll with the punches and back to the drawing board and get him what he needs.
The Fix team are about to begin their third case, tackling one of the UK's biggest rural crimes, sheep rustling. I'm in Somerset to meet Mike, a farmer whose livelihood is being threatened by criminals stealing his sheep in the dead of night.
What's happened when you've lost sheep before? Can you just describe?
They pinched them in two transit vans, and one of the transit vans broke down. And they left them in the back of the transit van. And then when we let them out, nine of them were dead. They got suffocated, or they were trampled to death. To me, that was awful. What sort of people would just leave sheep to die in them circumstances, or let anything die in them circumstances?
Sheep rustling's one of the oldest crimes in Britain, and it's an increasing problem. It's thought almost 100,000 sheep are stolen every year, costing farmers millions of pounds.
How much of a problem is it around here?
Last year was a real problem, but the numbers are getting bigger. You know, whereas it used to be twos and threes and fours and fives, now it's trailer loads, lorry loads.
Entire flocks.
And there was one person up north had 600 pinched one night. Police don't stand a chance, you know, they've got to catch them red-handed.
I fed back what I'd learnt to the team in London.
Both sides of my family are farmers, so I'm kind of aware of actually what it's like to try and control a rural space.
An enormous challenge, I imagine. It's not like bolting your front door, is it? The space is the problem.
We need to do a kind of crime watch reconstruction. So we need to find out as much as possible about how the different crimes were committed, find out what was in common, because that's the only way we're going to really understand where the points that we can intervene in order to prevent it are.
All right.
Dr. Zoe Laughlin and Jude Pullen have come to the farm. Mike and his three sons have agreed to reconstruct the night their sheep were stolen.
Oh, Flask, here. Fetch him on.
Zoe is co-founder and director of the Institute of Making at University College London.
So when you're rustled, I mean, they do it pretty silently.
Yeah, they know what they're doing, and sheep will handle a lot different in the dark.
Will they be quieter or louder, the sheep?
They'll be quieter, but they'll group together more and run a lot easier.
So you have to be kind of a skilled shepherd to
round
up
sheep.
Oh, you've
got to know what you're doing. Yeah, it's not as simple as it looks.
Come on, Fern, here. Here, Fern, here, Floss.
So we're going to see how fast we can get them in.
Yeah, under a minute, I reckon.
Under a minute.
Jude is an award-winning design engineer. Like Zoe, he also grew up in the countryside.
Come on, these ones need to get going.
The rustle happens at an impressive pace. Within moments, the sheep are in the trailer.
So this is pretty impressive. You're getting this done in a relaxed way in about 2 minutes.
Well, yeah.
And you're saying if you wanted to, if you were a serious criminal, you could get this done in half that time.
Easy, yeah. If you were pushing, you could easily get it gone. And that's the simple one.
That's it.
you can't lock this road because it's public access.
Yeah, this is public, so they can't lock this road. Yeah, it's all too easy.
Sheep rustlers nearly always work at night. They cut out identifying ear tags and can take the sheep almost anywhere for slaughter or sale. In the last 10 years, only a handful of rustlers have been prosecuted. After the reconstruction, we head to a pub to talk through the potential solutions with Mike and a group of other local farmers.
Zoe and Jude have got some bits of tech and kit to show you, which hopefully we're going to be able to look at and pick apart.
First, Zoe tries an infrared beam.
And when something crosses the beam, they sound an alarm. You could easily imagine them between exit and entry points of fields and that kind of thing.
But the problem with that is we live there, and that's there, which is probably about 2.5 miles. By the time we've got dressed, got a vehicle, got a dog, because you would never go anywhere without a dog, would you? And got up there, they could be long gone.
Then ultraviolet dye, which is invisible until a UV light is shone on it.
Could be something that would be triggered to spray criminals. You'd spray their truck, you'd spray the sheep.
But then you've got to find who the criminal is to read the mark.
Yeah.
Then Jude shows off a sound-activated alarm, which he's hoping will detect when the sheep are distressed.
What is this?
This device is when the sort of bleats are at a gentle level, it wouldn't really send much of a signal. But when it gets too loud, it would transmit through this little device by Wi-Fi. And as you can see, if I check my phone, it's been alerting me that...
Sheep alert. What do you think, gentlemen? Is something like that viable? Could it work?
I think used with lambs at foot will bleat when they're distressed.
Yeah.
But store lambs, or hogs as we call them this time of year, very rarely do they bleat.
The farmers aren't convinced. They reject all of Zoe and Jude's first ideas. It's going to be a lot harder than they thought to combat sheep rustling. Back on Graham's case, Ross and Ruby have been called to Peterborough. Zoe's made a discovery that could revolutionise their project to give Graham back his voice.
Is that what I think it might be?
Are these tapes of Graham?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Builders were working in the attic and found an old box full of tapes.
Me, Graham, sitting with my daughter Louisa.
It's the first time Zoe's heard her husband's voice since his stroke.
Well, seven moods, you know.
Shouting at me.
Shouting at Louisa.
Is this Graham talking? Did he just say tea time?
Zoe's replying. But we did.
I love it.
You're not supposed to throw stones at the video camera.
Yeah. That's going to be great for gay people's attention.
No, that's great. I'm running from
that is a strong look.
Dad, say something.
I'm knackered.
With a quick flash.
I told you it's naughty. It is so naughty.
Yay!
And
it's
really nice looking at these lovebirds.
It's just amazing to actually see what he's really like. That's wicked.
Well, what are you used to be like?
Yeah,
it's still
but
what
still,
it is like.
It's just still there.
Just he can't get out.
Yeah.
Hard.
Now Ruby and Ross will take the tapes away to see if they can build Graham's own voice into their invention.
Seeing him in those videos and seeing who he was, and for him to have lost that. Imagine if that happened to you, and imagine if you went from who he was to being in the position he's in now. The fact that you would have any positivity about anything after that is just amazing, absolutely amazing. Anyway, I thought I needed to say that while I was thinking about it.
While Ross and Ruby start trawling through the tapes of Graham's voice, Yusuf is making progress with Oscar's bike.
There's a lot more that we need to do on the handlebars to make him comfortable, to make him feel stable.
Oscar can't grip the handlebars, so Yusuf designs and 3D prints various wrist attachments. But Oscar doesn't want obvious disability aids on his bike. Yusuf hits on a solution.
If we were to use Velcro and create a almost like a wristband for him, what it would mean is that we could have a surface on the handlebars that he could clip down into. The idea that he can kind of steer with it is one I'd like to explore.
Yusuf is getting help a little closer to home from an expert he knows can manufacture a Velcro armband.
My mum is helping out create the armband. The Velcro pads seem to be fairly easy to... What you get is a very strong grip being formed. So strong I can hold the handlebar.
But if Oscar is in danger, it easily rips off. And with a few final tweaks, it's time to put the months of work to the test.
I feel very responsible, but I don't want to put him in harm's way. And also, I don't want to disappoint him. You know, he's put a lot of faith in me.
Good luck.
Thanks, man. Thanks.
In a park near his home, Oscar and his friends and family are waiting to see if he can ride a bicycle. Over the last 8 months, Yusuf has built not one but two bikes. A mountain bike for longer journeys, and also Oscar's dream bike, an incredible BMX.
That's fantastic. Yeah.
The smartest BMX that you will see in Sandwell and Dudley.
Yusuf straps the Velcro band to one of Oscar's arms. The other arm is free to push the lever that operates the front and back brakes. It's the moment of truth. Bike trainer Lisa's there to keep an eye.
He's off.
Yes!
Yes! Again!
This is really, really wonderful.
Once he can do this, then hopefully he'll realise that he can do anything.
This feels to me like Yusuf has...
cracked it.
You said it.
Thank you.
No problem, mate. My pleasure, my pleasure. It's fine.
Thank you. You've changed his life, Yusuf. I really appreciate it.
Go on, then.
I'm really intrigued to see where he goes with it. Is he going to be a Paralympic cyclist? Is he going to be a BMX stunt rider doing tricks, who knows? His journey cycling is just kind of beginning.
Hi Malcolm, this is Zoe, ringing about the sheep rustling project. Have you got 10 minutes for me to ask you a few questions?
Having initially failed to impress the farmers with their tech, the team start speaking to the police, to vets, and leave no stone unturned.
So I've come to a livestock market to watch a sheep auction and really see how sheep are bought and sold.
Where are you from?
Every sheep has an ear tag with an electronic chip, which identifies it and the farm it's from.
They tell me you're ear tag man. You do chips that go anywhere else on the body or in the body?
It's just ear tags.
But thieves can easily remove the tags and replace them with new tags showing a different owner, stopping people knowing they've been stolen.
Acorn, I wasn't wrong. Again on the ear, back and out. £80.
Zoe thinks she has a solution.
Those tags are vulnerable. So I think this fix is about making something that's internal to the sheep, something that the sheep ingests can stay in there for the life of the sheep, but can be read by these readers. So really the next step is about prototyping those and looking at the materials. There's a lot to do.
Back in London, Zoe begins planning with Jude and Ross.
If we could get somehow a tag inside the sheep, then it couldn't be removed. So sheep actually have something that they already ingest if they need mineral supplements, and that's a bolus. So this is an example of a bolus. Sheep eat zones all the time, and part of their stomach is designed to hold heavy objects. If we could somehow get a tag inside a bolus, then we're looking at essentially an internal tag, which is much less easy to remove.
The problem with the current electronic ear tag is it uses radio waves and needs a specialist scanner to read it. Jude has a more modern solution.
You might want to consider one of these things, which is a Bluetooth transmitter.
And also a key benefit of that is that anyone can read it with their smartphone. We can give people an app and then anyone can look out for stolen sheep.
So with the app on a smartphone and a Bluetooth bolus inside a sheep, anyone can become a stolen sheep detective.
So can you get a Bluetooth chip into something that this size, or maybe maximum that size?
So that's about as big as it can get.
Yeah.
A bolus can sit in a sheep's stomach for its whole life without causing any harm. It's a perfect place to hide a tracking device.
So we need that inside that and a phone that can pick it up.
Yeah.
Jude gets straight to work. He miniaturizes the components and uses his 3D printer to build a tiny case for the batteries. Doctor of Materials Zoe will make the housing for the electronics.
Right, so I'm going to attempt to make a ceramic case in which the electronic gubbins will live. So I've made some plaster blanks. I then drill holes into them. So I just get a bit of slip in here. Pour it into the mould. Once it's been in the mould for a minute or so, the skin starts to form and you can tip out the remaining liquid clay. What's left is a wall and a skin of more solid stuff. I'm going to put them in the oven just to slowly dry them. Ta-da! So that's a slip cast cylinder, which then needs to be fired at 1,260 degrees centigrade, and that will vitrify the material. Fingers crossed nothing cracks or explodes.
After 36 hours, Zoe's joined by Jude, and then she lifts the lid on the kiln.
Look at them, the little beauties. Oh, I'm pleased with that.
And the battery-powered Bluetooth chip is ready to go.
Can we see if your thing fits into my slot?
Yeah. Boom, boom. That's a good idea.
Just to kick us off.
Okay.
Perfect.
Finally, the team dip the boluses in non-toxic wax to make them easier to swallow, add the electronics, and seal the lids.
Past 10 o'clock at night, and I go a bit doolally.
A visit to the shops has given Jude another idea, a way of making the existing ear tags tamper-proof.
I have an ear tag, and I have a tamper-evident tag, which you might have seen in clothing stores. These things spray ink all over your stolen shirt if you try and remove these.
Whoa!
I'm wondering whether that could actually be used to house the ink. Here goes. It's my replica sheep's ear. Let's see what happens if we cut through it. So there, that's quite a good bit of man.
So any rustler that cuts through Jude's ear tags will mark themselves and the sheep with indelible dye, making the sheep almost impossible to sell at auction.
We've got the ink spike here, and that's both blue for the visual, but it also contains UV invisible dye, but is visible with this.
After 4 months' work, the team have now come up with two new ideas to deter the criminals: a tamper-proof ear tag and a hidden tracking device.
We appear to have got the prototyping done, so here it is.
Now they need to put them to the test. In London, Ross is building a replacement for Graham's stylus. He's calling it the D-pad.
Which is a very quick, very small, very light little device for Graham to carry around or have with him, and it's going to allow him to control the app using arrow keys.
Ross enlists the help of his fiancée, Isabel, to build the D-pad. It's going to have a touchscreen similar to the ones found on smartphones. These work by sensing tiny electrical currents generated by contact with your fingers. With the lightest touch, Graham will be able to operate his tablet computer. They make the buttons by putting conductive paint on clear plastic vinyl. The electric buttons will then be mounted on incredibly light corrugated plastic, which Ross cuts with a laser cutter.
Perfect.
Meanwhile, Ruby's on a business trip in China. She's deciding the order of the statements, either in Graham's voice or using TV or film clips, using a computer program called a wireframe.
The point of a wireframe is to communicate to the rest of your team how the app should work. It allows you to just work out what's on this screen, where does it go, what can it do.
Both of them are now working through the night to get Graham's device ready as quickly as possible.
It's 1:45. The D-pad is wired up, and I think I've written the code, but I can't get it to upload to the board. And I think maybe it's to do with the way I've wired it up, but I'm not sure how to fix it.
After months of work, we're back at Mike's farm getting ready to reenact another sheep rustle. But this time, the farm will be monitored by our team's specially built sheep protection app, Herd It.
Be scared.
Mike!
Hey!
All right.
Hi, there, all right.
Hiya.
Good to see you.
Hi. Nice curry hands.
These guys have been working hard on your behalf.
Have they?
Yeah.
Does it work?
Well, that's what we're going to find out today.
So what we've got is a combination of two things. A bunch of ear tags, which are going to have dying. The other side of it is you're familiar with boluses, which is what you'd use with your standard applicator.
Yeah.
But we've basically put electronics in it that are going to transmit a signal like a beacon.
First, Jude's ink ear tags are fitted in the existing holes in the sheep's ears.
So there we go, and you can see it just coming through here. And there we go, clips in.
Very simple.
Bob's your teapot.
To take that ear tag out?
Yep.
Oh, I see, you'd have to cut it there.
So you'd have to get a pair of scissors.
I'm learning.
They thought for that, Mike.
No, that's
good. Yeah, but you saw if you cut there.
Yeah, but that's still. I'll let you off there. That's pretty
good. The bolus is swallowed painlessly by the sheep, with the welfare of the animal monitored by a local vet.
It's on.
Yeah.
She won't know anything about that.
It's something that you do all the time on the farm.
Yeah.
It's time to put the tech to the test.
Crack on with your rustle. Rustle!
Fetch them on, dogs.
Yeah. Come on.
Get it.
We've got to imagine it's the middle of the night, pitch black, but the rustlers are out, the lorry's off.
In the back of the van, the first layer of protection comes into play, the ink ear tags.
Well, let's just imagine the scene. I'm let's say, an inspector monitoring for rural crime. Can see some suspicious blue on the ear of the sheep here and this one. You're not going to miss that. But look at his hands. Proof that he's been up to no good. How long will it stay on?
So this is developed, you know, this dye for banks, and so it's permanent.
You're roughy-tufty sheep farmers. What do you think?
Yeah, no, it's very good. Very good, right? But I still say that there's nothing tying him back to the owner.
Yeah.
65, that's 65, found mid, 65, 65, 44 and a half, 65. Are they
coming out? As soon as sheep are offloaded at the market, it's time to see if the bolus actually works.
So the minute I opened my phone, it was telling me
instantly.
Yeah.
So sheep 36846 from flock number 4.
Yep.
This is Mike's phone, as it were, saying your sheep was last spotted at this location.
You just click, it opens the map.
So there you are, it's saying that's where we are.
It shows, look, they're at the livestock auction. Yeah. You could ring up
and tell Andrew Doble I've caught him.
Yeah, well, you could say, you've got my nicked sheep here.
The test was a spectacular success. The team hope all farmers will use this technology, meaning all their mobile phones become sheep detectors. As soon as a stolen sheep turns up, phones will pick up the signal. There'll be nowhere for a stolen sheep to hide.
The ownership of that sheep was brought into question. We could find a bolus to prove that it's not the vendor's sheep. We could then immediately not offer it for sale, contact Mike if it was his sheep, contact the police, and put it in their hands.
It sounds like, from what you're saying, that this could really, really work.
I think there's every possibility, yeah, that it could be one of the only ways of identifying rustled sheep. I think it's a brilliant achievement, which has got the potential to be rolled out across the country and, yeah, revolutionise traceability in sheep.
Wonderful to hear. You've got the technology to this point. What do you need to happen next to make this viable for other farmers?
We need to take this as evidence that the principle works and take it to the National Sheep Association.
Farmers Union, government departments. We need to ring people.
That's fantastic,
really.
I mean, you know, that's why you, yeah, well done.
<That's very cool. laughs>
Very impressive. That's all I can say on the subject. I mean, you shot me down. Got to learn to use a phone properly, you know? That's so important.
Back in London, the team are working flat out to finish Graham's reaction pad. Ruby's building four main pages into the app she's devised. Attention, quick statements, emotions, and environment. They should allow Graham to take part in any conversation.
It's something that will last a lifetime. For as long as he has something to say or something to react to, he'll be able to use this. And that's what's really exciting, because it's an evolving tool.
Working late into the night and the early morning, Ross has managed to finish the control pad. And to give Graham another option in case his hand gets tired, he's building him a joystick too.
Are you nervous?
Very nervous about the hardware not working, seeing as I was finishing it on the train up here.
He actually hasn't had any sleep.
At all?
Not, no.
Do you feel more affected by the emotionality of it than some of the other fixes?
I definitely felt a very, very strong emotional connection to this story right from the second that I saw it. You could be like your dad or your brother or anyone.
When you well up like that, Ruby, and, you know, I see Ross swaying slightly with the exhaustion of this situation, you've really tried and committed to this.
Hello.
After 6 months, they hope they've built something that will change Graham's life.
Hi, how are you?
We're excited.
It's lovely to see you both. Are you okay with us gathering around? Are you feeling a little bit excited or apprehensive? Not too bad.
What we've made for you, Graham, is this iPad has an app that's been made especially for you, designed entirely around your requirements. The D-pad with buttonhole mount.
Yeah. Complete with logo.
Complete with logo.
When you see the phrases in here, when they've got quotation marks, it means that we've used, in some cases, Zoe's voice or clips from TV and films. But every time you see just the phrase written as it is, we've actually found clips of you and your own voice from the home videos that we've dug out the attic, so that they're actually you. We went through about 50 hours of footage. So it was really nice for us actually to hear you speak and see you move, and that was really great.
All okay. Right. You ready?
Cool. Okay. All right, Graham. Over to you, I guess.
Hello,
heard you, Zoe.
That's a big smile, Graham.
Should we open the door, Graham?
Yes.
Graham, do you want to get up?
No!
No, not at the moment.
He's otherwise occupied.
Graham, does this feel good?
Yes.
That, just in and of itself, must be an enormous relief to you both.
Yeah.
Oh, what do you keep present here? I can hear you. I don't care what you say.
A well-earned rest and a drink.
Sorry.
Thanks, guys. Who's you speaking?
The app has hundreds of clips of Graham's voice and quotes from film and TV. More can be added at any time.
Is this going to help you communicate? Yes. You got that out before I could finish the sentence.
And he's only going to get faster and faster.
I'm busy, fuck off.
Yes.
So great to hear your voice coming through again.
Told you to fuck off twice and yet you're still
All right, we'll take the hint.
Thank you. So nice.
It was kind of just even more amazing than I thought. He got so quick at it, so fast. It was just so good. Give him a week. Think how fast he's going to be in a week. Yeah. I can't wait.
Go on, have a hug.
The team have finished their work. We leave Zoe and Graham to chat for the first time since his life-changing stroke.
And I've just had a wash.
You have? Are you ready to go out?
Yes.
Okay. Are you sorry for anything?
No!
So when I leave here tonight, you can say...
See you tomorrow.
Yeah.
See you tomorrow.
Our team's inventions are already changing lives. Oscar is getting more confident on his bike every day. The Fix team are meeting farmers' unions to drum up interest in their sheep protection system. Graham has left hospital and moved back home. Ross and Ruby have designed extra functions for his reaction pad app.
Wow!
Next time...
I just trip over a lot and I can't stop.
Can the team design a medical helmet with style for a young David Bowie fan? And build technology to give a partially sighted mum the freedom to go outdoors.
Brilliant.
We're here!
And help two brothers break the monotony of daily treatment.
And every time you fly, the red car accelerates.
I have never, ever seen this before.
Go online for more information about the fixes in this series, plus how to take part in the next series at the Big Life Fix website. Season's greetings from Dara and the gang next on BBC Two with the Mock the Week Christmas special.